Hello everyone, welcome to our Good Friday service. Hey, if you're able, can I invite you to stand to your feet all across this place and wherever you are? We're just going to take a moment today to worship together as we reflect on the cross on this Good Friday. So come on, let's worship together wherever we are.
Oh,
Worthy is the name.
Singing crucified. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. As we consider today the greatest sacrifice that has ever been known, as we consider today the greatest act of love that has ever been known, we're humbled, God. I am humbled again to consider how much you love me, how much you love us. Sacrifice that you paid so that we can have relationship with God. We say thank you. Amen. Amen. We're going to worship again later, but for now you can take your seats. I need to stop crying when I'm on this platform. Humbling, isn't it, how much God loves us when we consider how great he is and how great his sacrifice is so that we may have life and have life to the full. So glad that you are here, you've chosen to come and worship with us this morning on Good Friday. It's so great to see you and want to welcome you online if you're watching us later this evening. We hope you've had a great day and glad that you are joining us as well. I don't know, you might have been here for many, many weeks. This might be your first time. You might have been coming a couple of times, and we want to welcome you. If you are new or you're wanting to find out how you can become more part of our family, how you can get more involved, what other things we have going on, in our atrium cafe at the end of this morning's service, we have a Connect banner that is up with a great team of our Connect team, great team of people who are ready to talk to you. They're looking forward to welcoming you. They're looking forward to answering your questions and helping you feel more part of the church family. So if you'd like to, after our service is concluded, then make your way to the atrium and you can find them there. It's great also that we've got Adventure Kids in with us this morning. So Adventure Kids, we are glad that you're here. You might have picked up an activity pack on the way in, but we are glad that you are in and that you are worshipping with us as well this morning. It's great to have you. We're just going to take a moment to give of our tithes and our offering. And I just wanted to bring a very simple thought, really, as we consider us giving of our tithes, as we consider maybe bringing an offering over and above our tithe. You know, this weekend we're choosing to focus on God's extravagant love. Easter is a celebration of God's extravagant love for us. And if you asked me, I'd be hard pushed to work out, do I enjoy Easter or Christmas more? And I love both of them. But actually, for me, the significance of Easter is incredible, where we consider God's extravagant love towards us. And I was just simply thinking, I have just had a recent milestone birthday. And in some of the gifts I got, I don't know if you've ever been given an extravagant gift or you've been given a gift that has demonstrated so much thought and creativity that you're kind of a little bit wowed and a little bit overwhelmed. And I did actually was fortunate. I've been so blessed to receive some presents where I'm like, oh my goodness. This is incredible. I've had a couple of moments where I've literally been speechless and the family just look at me and go, oh, she's off again. And yet we're considering that's material gifts that I have been given. And not all extravagant loves have to be big. Yesterday morning, I was out early yesterday morning at Nottingham City prayer meeting. And on the way back, I thought, you know what? I'm just going to drive through the coffee drive-through, pick my husband up his favourite coffee, take him home a coffee. Just because I can. So not all gifts that we know are extravagant, but it's just that thought, isn't it? It's that someone's been thinking of us. And yet this weekend, we're thinking about how much God loves us, how much God has given for us. So the ways to give this morning are going to come up on the screen behind me, and we're just going to take a moment. Maybe you've given your standing order already like me. I'm going to take a moment to say thank you to God. Maybe I'm going to think, actually, is there something else I can do, God, this weekend out of my love for you? So let's take a moment just to thank God. If you want to make use of the car payments or the buckets there at the back of the room, you can do that. Why don't you join me in praying? Father, thank you. We thank you for your extravagant love. As we give of our tithes and our offering this morning, it might feel like the widow's mite. It might feel that we're just bringing a tiny gift back to you, back to honour you. But Lord, we do this because out of our gratitude of your extravagant love towards us. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to go back into a time of worship. We're not just going to sing one song. We're going to have a time of worship here. And I just want to encourage you. I don't know, you might be in the worship just before I got up on the platform. I was really moved because I was considering again and afresh God's sacrifice to us. I was having again a revelation of how much God loves us. And that's what we can be doing today. We've got some time, we've got some space. So allow yourself to respond to God. Allow yourself to for God and it through His Holy Spirit to minister to your heart. And if you feel like you need to cry, you can cry. If you feel like you need to lie down on the floor, you can lie down on the floor. If you need to kneel, you need to kneel. We've got some space here today. So I want us to encourage, to engage us in this time here. So can I encourage you to stand? And we're going to go back into worship. And just to say, parents, there is a room, if you've got a four-year-old and under that gets a bit restless, there is a room with some toys set out for you to go and stay with them. The host team can show you where that is. And if you've got a baby here, we've also got our new parent room for parents with children under 1 year old. So feel free, parents, if you need to, you can take advantage of that. But also, Adventure Kids, you can join in this worship. You can bring your worship to God. We'd love to see that too. So let's worship together.
Stand with arms high and heart abandoned, able on the one. Jesus, we're in awe of you. Lord, what else can we do but praise you? What else can we do but worship you? What else can we do but say, here we are, have our lives. Oh, Jesus, we glorify you. God, all we have is yours. Oh, Jesus. We praise you here this morning, Lord God. We thank you for what we've done. We praise you for who you are. Praise you, God. Amen. Amen, church. Take your seats if you can. We're going to open the Bible together. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 27, if you want to go there. You know, there are too many things to say about Good Friday. There's too many. So there's going to be a lot that's going to be left unsaid today. So I hope that's okay. What we're going to do today is, I don't want to try and do anything too clever. I simply want us to look at the reality of this day. I want us to look at what happened and why it happened. And then we're going to share communion together at the end. And I believe we're going to have an encounter with Jesus Christ this morning. I believe he's going to come and do some stuff in us this morning. So I've got real faith as we break bread together that God is here. And you know what? Like, I don't know whether you have too, but I've felt the presence of God this morning as we've worshipped him. Come, Holy Spirit, come and speak to us as we look upon you. Let's read together Matthew 27, verses 27 through to verse 50. It says, we're going to read the story of what happened to Jesus. Just to set the scene, he has already been betrayed. He has been arrested. He's had his trial. And this is where we find ourselves here. It says, then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters. And they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. When after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and they knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him. They took a reed and they struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. And over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross." And in the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and the elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He can't even save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and then we'll believe him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'" And the bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3 p.m, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And when some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling Elijah." At once, one of them ran to get a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the other says, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. And at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. You know, church, we can't escape the horrendous nature of this day. This is a bad day, and yet it's a good day. Crucifixion in the history of humanity is up there as one of the most barbaric punishments and execution styles that there has ever been in the history of the world. It was so bad that the Romans, unless someone had committed treason, they wouldn't do it to their own people. They would only do it to slaves and foreigners who they saw as less than Roman citizens. And even then, it was only reserved for the worst crimes. The Romans seemed to have a certain disdain for their own practice of crucifixion. It is horrendous. It would take hours or days for someone to die, having been strung up and nailed to a cross. Slowly, they would suffocate over hours and days. And as we've just read, it would also give plenty of time for those people around to mock and scorn the person who was dying. It was done in public and in full view of everyone. It's one of the worst things that a human being in history would ever have to endure. But for the Jews, it was all of that and more. For the Jews, it was even worse than that, because in the book of the law in Deuteronomy, verse 21, verse 23, it says, "For anyone hung on a tree is under God's curse." So the Jews at the time saw crucifixion, although it wasn't a hanging from the neck, you were hung on a tree. And Jews, whenever the Romans crucified Jews, and they did, and sometimes they did it en masse, there was outcry, because it wasn't just a shame and a scorn from a human being's perspective. For them in their Jewish culture, it was also that they were under a curse from their God. So to hang a Jew on a tree is not only to physically abuse them, it is to put them in a place where they are now distanced and separated from their very God, under a curse from God. So this moment where Jesus is crucified with that mocking title of "This is Jesus, King of the Jews," strewn over his head, is a moment of utter and abject defeat. The Roman Empire is saying, "This man is King of the Jews." No. Caesar's King of the Jews. Right? Every single time the Jewish people tried to do an uprising against the Romans, they were crushed utterly. And this is the Roman Empire, the Gentile world of the day, saying, "We're the King of the Jews. This man is not the King of the Jews. We've defeated him. If you thought he was your king, wrong. Caesar is your king. This king, he's dying." And from a Jewish perspective, any thoughts or hopes that this man was the anointed one, the Messiah, the Savior, have also, it would seem, ended in this moment, because not only is he not that because he's lying dying on a cross, he's under a curse from God. And so even within his own people, this moment where Jesus comes and is crucified brutally, both from outside of his community and from inside of his community, this is a horrendous day in which Jesus is utterly crushed and defeated from all angles. However you look at this, on the surface, this is an utterly devastating, terrible, terrible day. Because not only is he dying, but there is no way he could be the Messiah. There's no way he could be the Savior, because he's been defeated by the Roman Empire, and he lies dying, cursed by God, hanging on a tree. And yet, if you look at the story of Jesus, he talks about his death quite a lot. He predicts his own death 3 times. In every single gospel that we've got, you have stories of Jesus describing that he is going to die and describing how he is going to die, predicting it in his life. He tells parables about this moment. He tells stories about his death. He even says that his death will be the fulfillment of all the Old Testament prophecies. When we see in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he is crying out in anguish, he seems to suggest explicitly that his death is the will of God the Father that he is submitting to, and seems to be the very, very reason that he came. is this moment of utter defeat where both for the Roman Empire and the Jewish people, he is utterly crushed and broken and proved to be not who he said he was. And if you look through your New Testament, and it doesn't take long to get here, you see that this moment of his death is the central story to the life of the church. It immediately, from the very word go, it's the moment of his death on the cross, this utter defeat, this utter shame, this utter curse. This is the moment that they focus their entire lives around. In 1 Corinthians verse 1, chapter 18, the Apostle Paul's right. He writes, for the message of the cross, so first of all, he's saying his whole message is about the cross, is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The message of the cross is the power of God. Later in chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says, I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now, I'm not about to say that the other things aren't important, but notice he doesn't say, and him resurrected. He doesn't say, I'd resolve to know nothing among you except Christ and him resurrected. Or I didn't want to know anything among you except Christ and him ascended to heaven. No. He says, nothing but him crucified. Him cursed by God on a tree, beaten, battered, defeated. And in Galatians 6, again, it says, May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wait. So not only is it central to everything in their lives, he's saying, don't boast. You know all those things that you could boast about? Don't boast about those. Boast in the defeated, cursed Jesus, the Jew hanging on a tree, cursed by God, defeated by the Roman Empire, suffering, losing. We're going to boast about that. Like, isn't that incredible? Like, that seems totally the wrong way around to me. That seems totally the wrong thing to be focusing on. Why are we focusing? Why is this the thing that is there? Shouldn't this be swept under the carpet? Shouldn't this be pushed to the side? Shouldn't we be focusing on his resurrection rather than his crucifixion? In Acts, in chapter 5, in chapter 10, and chapter 13, the book that documents the early church spreading across the world, it explicitly talks about Jesus Christ, the one who was killed on that tree. On that tree, on the tree. It is literally saying at the core of our faith is the one who was cursed, who was under a curse from God. It doesn't even say cross. It literally says on the tree. Well, every Jew in that moment goes, okay, well, we know what you're saying. You're saying the one who died under a curse from God. So they're not just sweeping this under the rug. It's like front and center, the message of the cross as the foundation of what Jesus said he came to do. And from the moment after he died, that they all seem to be building the entire power and future and life of their lives upon is this moment of his death. And are being explicit about how bad it was. So why, if this was such a terrible day, why is this the thing? Maybe this wasn't all what it seemed. Maybe what's happening here at the cross on the surface level wasn't all that was going on. Because sometimes appearances can be deceiving. So why did Jesus die? What's happening? If it's not just everything I've described to you, then why is he dying? What's happening? Well, to answer that question, we have to talk about sin. The Bible talks about this word called sin, which is not a word that we use very often in our normal lives, right? We wouldn't say someone sinned against me or that's just outside of church or Bible reading, maybe. Sin is not a word that in our normal English language gets used a lot. But the Bible describes sin. Effectively, sin is anything that is anti-God. Anything that is against God and his holiness and his righteousness, the Bible describes as sin. The Bible says that sin entered the world in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve, they decided to go against what God said. They went anti-God. They went against what God said, and they allowed sin into the world. And in Genesis chapter 4, verse 7, which is, you know, just a few chapters later, God says, and if you do not do well, sin is lurking at your door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it. You see, we think of sin sometimes as being the bad list, the list of things that if you do them at school, you'll get told off, right? Or the things that have negative consequences, lying, stealing, lust, jealousy, pride, selfishness, I don't know, stealing, all the things that you can think of, and those are sins, but that's not the whole of sin. The Bible says sin is this thing that is anti-God, and actually it kind of personifies it, like it's lurking, ready to take you. We as human beings, we can't help it but to go against God. We're just desperate to put ourselves at the top of the tree and think, well, no, I know, but I know better, right? We can't help but lie. We can't help but lust. We can't help but be jealous. We just can't help it. We can't help ourselves because we're human beings. And in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul, in one of the most helpful chapters of the Bible, in Romans chapter 7, if you're struggling with sin and things that you know are not good, go read Romans chapter 7. It will encourage you. Paul says, all these things that I want to do, I can't do. All these things that I know I shouldn't do, they're the things I end up doing. And he says, it's not me, it's sin living inside me. So in the New Testament, we see that sin is not just outside of me trying to get me. Actually, it can get on the inside of me. That anti-godness, that against God, that falling short of God can get on the inside. And Paul talks about it almost like it's like a cancer eating me from the inside out. So sin is a problem. It's a problem. It's inside us. It's outside of us. It's everywhere in our actions, in our deeds. We all know, if I said, how many of you lied this week? Some of you, if you thought long enough, you go, yeah, I did. I did exaggerate that thing. I wasn't honest about this, etc. But it's deeper than that. Because in Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6, it says this. It says, all our righteous deeds. So righteous is right living. That's good stuff. If you've got the bad list at school that gets you in trouble, then there's the good list that gets you rewards. He says, even that are like, it's like a filthy cloth, right? So I'm sorry, this is not good news, this bit of the message. Even the good stuff that you've done has sin in it. It's stained. It is dirtied by the presence of our selfish ambition and our sin and that part of us that doesn't want to submit to God. The Bible says that even your good stuff isn't good enough. We do not have a faith that says your bad things count against you and your good deeds count for you. And hopefully at the end of your life, the scales weigh in the right direction. That is not the Christian faith. The Christian faith says your good works needed forgiving as much as your bad things. Right? Which is bad, right? And in our society, that's a hard thing to hear, I think, in our society. That says, you're amazing. There's nothing wrong with you. It's their problem. It's not your problem. And when God wants to come and go, hang on a second, I've made you for better than that. Or when the Holy Spirit wants to come and speak to you and say, hey, I don't like this part of your life. I want to draw you into a close relationship with me. It's hard in today's society to hear that and believe that there might be a problem with me. That maybe I have a problem that I need help sorting out. Although deep down, I think we all know that we're not as good as perhaps we're told we are. And perhaps there's more things that we hide than we'd care to admit. The Bible says that we've got a problem. And this is bad news. But in this moment of bad news, we have some very, 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 very good news. Because the Bible says that instead of inflicting the consequences, the Bible says that the consequences of sin ultimately is death. Death both physically and separation from God. And the Bible says that instead of bringing those consequences upon the people who deserved it, he didn't do that. The Bible teaches us that in this moment when Jesus is dying on the cross, the most horrendous death that one of the most horrendous deaths a human being has ever experienced, and the most cursed way for a Jew to be killed, that something even worse is happening to Jesus in this moment. He is God. He is holy. He is perfect. He is the one who cannot even look upon sin. He is the one for whom sin creates a distance between us and him because he will not tolerate it in his presence. And yet in this moment, the Bible tells us that the sin of the world is being cast onto and into Jesus Christ on the cross. Even worse than what it looks like is what's happening to Jesus in this moment. In Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, this is God and Jesus. It says, for our sake, he, God, made Jesus. For our sake, God the Father made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Not our righteousness that's stained, but his pure, true holiness and righteousness. In 1 Peter 2:24, it says, and I mean, I've picked two of countless scriptures that talk about this. It says, he himself, Jesus, bore our sins in his body on the cross so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. So this is good news. This is good news because everything that was required of me when I sin, when we sin, we have a problem that we cannot get back from. See, sin is defined by its relationship to God. It's anti-God. So only God can sort it out. You and me cannot sort it out. Only God can. And this is the moment that he did. He took the sin, the judgment, and the human death upon himself so that you and I could receive his eternal life. He took our punishment so we could receive his glory. He took our sin so that we could receive his righteousness. And what I love is that this moment of his death on the cross is not leading to victory. It is the victory. If you want to see the glorified, if you want to see Christ in his glory, look no further than the cross. Look no further than the Jew cursed, hanging on a tree, dying in agony, taking on the sin of the world, God allowing his perfect nature to be tainted and stained and punished by sin that is so abhorrent to who he is. This is the victory. This is the moment of glory. This is the moment at which our sin was cast away from us and onto Jesus Christ. And eternal life was open for us. Relationship with God was open for us. This is the moment. This is not leading to victory. This is victory. We don't need to wait till Sunday. This is the victory. I resolve to know nothing among you but Christ and him crucified. It's the cross of Christ that is the power of God. This is the moment where grace was given to us all. And all we had to do was put our faith in his saving work. Christ is Lord and my Savior, and we get to receive everything from God. Every part of you that you deep down know is broken or whole or is missing something or is stained can be wiped clean because of this moment. This moment, the Jew hanging on a tree, dying, cursed, slain for the world. This is the moment at which you receive life. I receive life. So, we're going to break bread together. If you should have hopefully got one on your way, and if you didn't, put your hand up and the host team will come and we're going to share it in a minute. Because I've got real faith here, you know. I think some of us, including me, I feel God's presence here. I think God wants to meet with me, as in me, and he wants to meet with us. I think some of us need to know this. I think some of us need to know this, and some of us need to experience a revelation of this deep down. And I've got a few things that I want to say. And in a few minutes, we will take and eat together. In Corinthians, when Paul describes breaking of bread, he describes how Jesus talked about his body broken that would be broken on the cross on the night before he was going to be crucified. And he talked about his blood shed for us, that he would be shed on the cross. And in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26, he says, this meal we're going to take. He says, For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, what do? He says, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Again, interesting. He doesn't say you proclaim the Lord's life. And listen, Jesus is alive. And on Sunday, we're going to celebrate the fact that Jesus is alive. But it's his death that we're proclaiming. That death that I described earlier, but actually the reason why we want to proclaim his death is because this is the moment when my life could change forever. This is the moment. This is the moment that every single thing of our lives is built on, not just once, but the Bible says every day it's supposed to be built on this. You know when he says, I don't boast in anything? He's like, all those things that you want to boast about, elsewhere the Bible talks about boasting in our weakness and stuff, all that other stuff, you should do that in the context of knowing, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that death. My whole life, my eternal life is not built on what I can do, what I did, how good I am. It is built ultimately on this moment because this is the only way that I could have been reconciled back to God. I can't do it on my own. But I really feel like there's a few different things that I want to lead us in. I think there are some people that when we break bread in a minute need to come out of their seats and need to come to the front and need to be prayed for. And there's a couple of things. One is, I think it's about how deep has this gone in our hearts. There are two things that happen. He's taking our sin from us, and he's giving us his life. And I feel like maybe there are some people here who, not necessarily that you feel trapped in sin, although maybe that is you, but you just need to give it to Jesus. I feel like there are some people here that you just need to surrender everything to Jesus. The Bible says the only way we can get to the Father is through this moment of Jesus dying on a cross. You need to surrender the fact that you're not good enough on your own. There is a depth of which you're trying to do this too much on your own, and you need to go, God, I need to come back and remember that this is all based on you. This is all from you. This is all for you. None of this was from me, and I need to give my sin. I need to leave some stuff here at the cross. Maybe it's unforgiveness. Maybe it's bitterness. I don't know what it is, but there's stuff that you need to go, actually, do you know what? I need to leave some stuff here. And then the other thing I really feel strongly is that there's some people here that need a revelation, and maybe you need to come out and be prayed for, of just how deserving of this God decided you were. He wanted to do all those things that I said he did for you. And that is so hard for us to get our heads around, because I think deep down, I know certainly, I don't deserve this. I don't want him to die for me. I'm not worth it. And he goes, you're wrong. I don't care what you think. I know what's true of you. I'm speaking as God there, by the way. Just that, you know. He doesn't care what I think about myself. He says, you were worth it. You were worth it. And do you know what? When you know that you were worth Christ dying for, I just feel like there's some people that need to know that today. And you need to be prayed for. And you need to break bread with someone here at the front and go, I need to know that. And I believe that God is going to pour a revelation into you as you come and meet with Jesus, that you were, live like you were, believe that you were. Because you were, because he said you were. Why would he go through all of that if you weren't? Why would he have endured one of the worst things a human being could go through if he didn't think you were worth it? You were, and he wants to show you that you were. He wants to take that sin away from you, and he wants to bring it back. And the final kind of thing that I feel is that, you know, we can slip back into thinking we're a good boy or a good girl and a bad girl so quickly, right? I do well, I feel good. I've been bad on the internet this week, and I feel bad, and I don't want to pray, and I don't want to speak to God. The Bible doesn't want us, Jesus says he doesn't want us to be enslaved to sin. He doesn't want us to live in sin. But boy, does he not want us to live in some kind of, I did good, so I'm feeling good. I did bad, and I did bad. He says, no, even the good stuff wasn't that good. The bad stuff, I took that upon myself. Come and be freed. Come and be freed from this roller coaster life of like, I'm doing great, so I'm going to pray. I'm doing bad, I'm not going to pray. I'm not even going to church. Like, come and be free from that. I don't think he wants that for your life. He doesn't want that. That's not the grace that he won for you. He didn't do that so that you could do that. He said so you could place every single moment of your life within his death, not your goodness or your death, his death, so that you could have life. So the worship team are going to lead us. Let's pray. Come out of your seat. If you know that's you, we've got some pastoral team here who are going to pray for you. Just if you're any of those people, or if you just want to come and, I don't know, you just meet, Jesus is doing something in your life, in your heart. Come forward. Come and kneel on this hard floor. Come and do whatever you need to do to come and just experience something that God is doing in you. Amazing. Let me pray, and then as and when you're ready, you can break bread and fix our eyes on the Savior who died and in this moment won our eternal life for us. Lord Jesus, we fix our eyes on you, crucified and died for us. Lord God, we want to meet with you. Come, Jesus. Come, Jesus, and bring the power of your cross into this moment, Lord God. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. Churches, as and when you feel, just break bread together. If you're with someone, you could do that together, or you could do that on your own. And if nothing else, say a prayer that is just says, God, everything I have is because of what you did. Give your life to him again if you need to. Surrender your heart to him again if you need to. Give him your all like he gave his all to you if you need to. Or just gaze in wonder and glory at the things that he was willing to do for you, and that this is the foundation of every single day of our lives. Him broken for you to be made whole. Come, Holy Spirit. The worship team are going to lead us, and just keep doing whatever you need to do. If you're being prayed for, if you're just whatever it is, just don't worry what else is going on. You just keep meeting with God and allowing Him to come and speak into your life as we just take some moments just to fix our eyes on our King.
Oh,
this moment, we don't have to, as Andrew has very well explained to us, we don't have to feel that we're polished, we've got it all sewn up, we know what we're doing. God is just after our hearts. God is looking to see whether we can surrender, whether we accept that He is God, whether He is Lord. He has died to take our wrongdoing. We can come to Him imperfect, messed up. We're welcome at the foot of the cross. And I just want to encourage you this morning, if you are responding to God, maybe for the first time this morning, I want you to take this moment. This is your moment. And if you are responding to God for the first time, I don't know whether you can just indicate to me, if you just can be brave enough to put your hand up, wave at me so I can see. If you are responding to God, that is fantastic. What a great day to respond to God. What a great day to begin to understand how loved and welcome we are. Fantastic. So great to hear people are responding to God. And in a moment, we're going to come to the end of our service. We're going to move on. But I also want to encourage you, if you need to stay, if you need to linger in the presence of God here for a moment, if you just need to stay, that's absolutely fine. There's no pressure for you to rush on. But I'm going to draw the meeting towards its end so that some of us can also move on too. If you have responded, I'm excited. If you've responded, we want to help you, and we want to help you. We're not wanting to now just go, well, that's it, you heard Andrew preach, go away and figure it out yourselves. I would, if you could be brave enough to come forward, we have a response area over here. We would love to talk to you, chat to you, and help you on your next steps of understanding what this momentous decision that you have made is. Also, I know that I might have been a Christian a long time, but actually there are some things in me that I just need to put back into the right order, and I need God's help with that. Then we also still have our team. We have our response area over here. If you would value somebody praying with you and standing with you, then please, by all means, come over. If you've been watching online, if you've responded, or if you've got to rush off this morning, then head to our website, heart.church/response, and you can fill an online form in there, and one of our team will be in touch with you. We want to help you. Andrew, thank you so much. What a great, we show our appreciation to Andrew. Thank you so much, Andrew. Really appreciate that. And before I pray for us to finish this morning, I just want to, who's looking forward to Easter Sunday? Looking forward to celebrating together. So I look forward to seeing you here 10:30 on Easter Sunday. Adventure Kids, I've heard that you can come fancy dress. And Adventure Kids, I've also heard there might be a few surprises in store on Sunday morning. So come ready and expectant. And I just want to encourage us. I expect it to be a busy day. So can I encourage us to let's aim to be in the studio for 10:15. Let's not forget that it's quite a long walk from the car park sometimes to get into here. Hey, let's encourage us to come expectant that we could even get to our seats in the studio in order to be like, you know what, God, I'm here, I'm ready to bring my worship and praise to you. So look forward to seeing you on Sunday morning. But let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for the time we've had today to be able to pause and remember your sacrificial love, that your light shone into the darkness, that's revealed hope out of devastation, and that's spoken truth through incrimination and brought us forgiveness instead of punishment. Thank you. We can now walk in the light of your life, in your hope, your truth, your freedom and forgiveness this day and every day. We are a grateful people, God. Amen. Amen. So please be mindful if people are still wanting to have a moment to respond. Please be mindful of that. But for the rest of us, that church continues in the Atrium Cafe, and we look forward to celebrating with you on Sunday. God bless.